Hi, welcome back to Mingis on Tech. I'm Ken Mingis, Executive News Editor for Computerworld for December 1st, 2016. I'm here with Chief Content Officer for IDGE, John Gallant. Senior Features Editor?
Yeah.
Is that the right? Tracy Mayer.
Good job.
And we're here to be soothsayers and take a look at our Forecast 2017 special report and try to get an idea for what's coming up next year for IT and what everybody needs to know.
Great.
So, Tracy, original research, what did we find out?
Right. So this is one thing we really like about this survey is it's all senior IT people. So we're really talking to the cream of the crop, and it's a pretty small sample, but pretty intense group of people, and they really have their eye on what's going
on. Great piece of research.
Yeah, and a lot of stuff in there, but we asked them a bunch of different questions, but one of them is the trends that they're watching right now, which, you know, going into 2017, what's on their front burner, but then also disruptive trends, so stuff that they think is going to disrupt their business in the next 3 to 5 years. So we're sort of looking at those two things together.
Right.
Okay.
So one thing that's super interesting to me is the number one trend that they're worried about right now is security, which is
not a surprise.
Right.
And that's sort of a perennial issue,
right,
in terms of IT.
Right. And you know, every year it's like global warming. Every year it gets more.
Right.
You say nothing can be as bad as 2016, and then here comes 2017.
Right.
But what's very interesting is the number one disruptive trend is Internet of Things,
right,
and
IoT.
Telematics. So this survey was fielded in the fall before the Mirai malware kind of blew up.
Right.
So what do we think about that now?
Well, I think the most important thing is to take a step back and consider the opportunity of Internet Things before we think of all the problems associated with Internet of Things. And I was glad to see it listed so high among the items that you talk with readers about, because there's so much potential with Internet of Things. When I talk to IT leaders, CIOs, and other top IT executives, the information possibilities of this are incredible. What you can learn, how you can turn products into services, for example, create ongoing revenue streams through Internet of Things, learn more about the customers so you're fine-tuning your products. Talk to one software maker that actually uses Internet of Things applications with their own software applications to see which features people are using and which they're not in the software so that they can base their development on that going forward. That said, the problem with security is that someone's always one step ahead of you thinking of where are the flaws, where are the holes that you haven't thought about. And that's clearly one of the big issues with Internet of Things. Lots of devices, lots of products out there with capabilities to communicate that are connected to the internet. That was a big flaw, a big risk that people weren't paying enough attention to.
Yeah, it really seems like the whole idea with IoT is everybody saw the potential, as
right.
you mentioned, jumped in without really sort of building in the security that you need, because you've got this data flowing in so many directions and no way to really protect it. And also you've got so many devices now that can be harnessed for good or bad, you know. And so the idea that security, I just wonder if we think that the security concerns might have people pulling back a little bit on IoT until they get a handle on how to protect this.
I would have to think after that story broke that you would have a meeting the next day and say, what is going on here, or, you know, what kind of a handle we have on this?
Yeah, I mean, I think it will do that, but I think the bigger challenge with IoT is that not enough senior IT executives are really taking advantage of that opportunity to lead in their company. They really should be looking at IoT as an opportunity to connect the business value with the IT value that they create. And I hope it doesn't dissuade people from doing that.
Right. Yeah. Just maybe have the security people in the room a little sooner
One
on.
One would hope so, yeah.
So
what else?
So kind of interesting. Some of this stuff, you know, I mean, we cover this all the time. Yeah. So on the trends that people are doing right now, number two is analytics. Obviously, we cover that a lot.
Right.
We talk about it a lot. Anything as a service, which of course ties into the cloud. Mobile apps was on that list, which I was a little bit interested in. Virtualization.
Yeah.
So those are the top five.
Mm-hmm.
I think sometimes what happens is that you know, everyone's like, oh, virtualization's hot or mobile apps are hot, and that was so last year. But it takes time for you to actually get those things going. So when you say to an IT leader, what is your priority this year? It's like, oh, it's that thing that was hot 2 years ago. We're finally
getting around to it.
Well, we're finally rolling it out.
We're talking about the front of the bell curve.
Right, right. So something like mobile apps, which, you know, feels like 2 years ago or 3 years ago.
Further back than that,
It's interesting, actually, in the that we actually reported, we had a couple different companies who were working on, they're actually working on mobile, but not apps. So they're doing they're delivering mobile services.
What kinds of things are they
doing? Well, they're doing mobile services, but they're, right, they've moved away from app.
Really focused more on the website and making the website
so
more
making
capable.
Yeah. So I mean, is that, I think that's a thing, right? People are kind of moving away from app.
Well, I think there's some app exhaustion. Number one, people have a lot of apps. They don't use a lot of the apps that they have. Trying to figure out, you know, which is the right environments for the apps and which kinds of mobile devices people are using and what's the right sweet spot. That's a challenge. And I think the focus on more dynamic, more mobile friendly websites certainly makes sense in light of that.
Right. Yeah. So I think it's, yeah, mobile, not necessarily apps.
Yeah, I agree. It's interesting that it came out as mobile apps because it does feel like there's been a trend away from apps. A lot of app development going on, but right, as John makes the point, you know, how many of us have apps on our phone? And again, that's not enterprise apps, but it's the same sort of thing where, you know, you download it, it looks like something you're going to be able to use, and then you never touch it again.
Right.
And so there's got to be some way to get to connect mobile to customers and to users without necessarily having to go through an app store.
Right.
You know?
Right.
And then, yeah, if you hit somebody's mobile-friendly website once, you don't have to, you know, go through the whole sign-in and all
that. And there's
a
tremendous
stuff.
Amount of work to be done there,
oh,
because,
yeah,
as we know, there's a lot of mobile sites that are terrible experiences. Yeah, a lot of sites that are terrible experiences.
Black Friday shopping on my phone, which I would not recommend. So on the disruptive side, obviously IoT was number one over there. Self-service IT, which I'm going to get back to, mobile payments,
right,
which, yeah, again, right, we could totally use some more mobile payments. But even in the enterprise, they're really working on interfacing with people in a mobile environment.
Right.
And if you have any kind of customer-facing company, you need to be working on that. Artificial intelligence, which I kind of think is really going to come into its own, or it's more start to come into its own next
right
year,
yeah,
right? I mean, it seems like people are actually kind of getting their feet under them. Same thing with IoT, they're figuring it out.
I was covering software back in the 80s. I shouldn't be dating myself on your show like this, but artificial intelligence was a hot topic right back then. And then we sort of went into this kind of dark winter where we didn't talk much about artificial intelligence. To me, it's wonderful to see this come back as a topic, and it really is kind of the front edge, the knife edge of the analytics discussion, which is how do we take all of this information that we have and how do we glean greater insights and put those insights to use for a wider group of folks. So having talked to the folks at IBM, example, about the many ways of putting the Watson technology to work, it basically sorts through all of the knowledge, all of the learning, all of the content, and it starts to think like the best people in any particular business, the best doctors, the best financial folks. This is what we really need to apply to a lot of different problems. So I'm really excited about this artificial intelligence trend.
Yeah, it does feel like, you know, as you say, this is something that's been floating around for 30 years. But it feels like we've finally gotten to a point where we've caught up with analytics. We've caught up with the hardware to process
right
this stuff.
Right.
We can finally put the pieces together and actually get something at the end that's
right
useful.
It seems like, you know, it's a good year for it to kind of hockey stick and
right
go
yeah
way up from sort of bubbling along.
Right.
And if you're going to touch on the self-service thing, what it does also is it starts to make life easier, I think, for IT, because we start to find ways to help people resolve their own problems as opposed to requiring IT to solve their problems every time.
Right. That was kind of a surprise, self-service IT bumping up as a disruptive.
Well, if you're an IT shop, it could
right
be easily.
If you're working in tech, it could totally disrupt.
Yeah.
But so people are, I mean, so these are senior IT leaders who are saying self-service IT is something that they're watching closely.
Right.
But, you know, I kind of had a little bit of a question in our kind of main focus on this piece was that hiring is flat. It's predicted to be flat for next year. And spending was flat for next year, which was a contrast from the last couple of years where it had kind of bumped up.
Inched up a bit, yeah.
So if spending's flat, hiring's flat, and then
there's
you have these like
IT,
self-service IT,
you know,
things, you know, that might not be so great for the rank and file. The IT managers are happy, but it might, you know, maybe that's a little, you know, bat squeak up
yeah
there for the rank and file.
And I actually...
You were going to disagree on
this. I disagree on this wholeheartedly.
We were talking about this earlier.
I think this is an absolute imperative for IT. The biggest reason is you have to shift this this balance around between spending all your time and money on the things you've already built and that you're already running towards innovation.
Right.
And you can't do it unless you get to the self-service equation. That allows you, yes, maybe to shift some jobs, some traditional jobs, but that allows you to hire in areas like cloud. It allows you to hire people who know analytics. It allows you to hire people who can focus on Internet of Things. All of those are going to be very challenging areas to hire in, but you can't do it unless you free up resources. You have to look at that cloud model that we talk a lot about. You don't talk to anyone at Amazon.
Right.
When you set up your Amazon instances,
right,
you have to get much more toward that environment, much more cloud-like, if you're going to achieve any of the innovation goals you have.
Right. Right. Especially if you have flat headcount, right?
Exactly.
You
need to if you've got X number of people and you're going to have some things you need to innovate on, you're going to need to offload something somewhere.
Exactly.
So self-service IT in that case makes sense.
Right. Well, it'll be interesting to watch, see what happens with the skills.
We'll be
all
back
that
in a
stuff.
Year to let you know how it turns out.
Exactly.
So any other insights real quick before we wrap this up?
No. Everything's online. It's a huge package. There's all kinds of content, and we have videos and slideshows, and there's, however you want to consume it all. But there's a lot of information there.
But you also have something free and wonderful.
Our favorite four-letter word.
For readers.
I know. But this year, for the first time, this is a downloadable, so you can clip and save and read it on the train. It's the entire survey, all the results. So, we've done a lot of interpreting here, but if there's something you want to dig down on that's, we asked about, we asked a lot of stuff about digital transformation, stuff like that. So there's a lot of detail in here, and it's on the website. It's a free downloadable, so you can
click and
save.
Great. All right, so that's our quick look at the Forecast 2017
Tech Forecast.
IT sharpens its focus. Great.
Yes, cool.
Tracy, thanks so much for stopping
by.
John, thanks for stopping by.
Pleasure.
For now, that's a wrap.